You may have been hearing a lot of talk about Palantir, the secretive tech company working with CIA, FBI, NSA, drumming up a lot of controversy and generally being the black sheep of the tech world. But one thing that people have a hard time explaining and or understanding is, what does Palantir do? What does it actually do? I'll answer that question and others, and I will share my Palantir holdings. Yes, I own some, full disclosure. I'll share my holdings at the end of this video. Also, I'll show you a clip that Palantir released recently that doesn't seem like much on the surface, but it's kind of mind-blowing once you think about what it's saying between the lines. It will blow your mind. Stick around. To understand Palantir, it's important to understand the importance of data. The modern world collects a lot of data. We collect it with satellites, with video surveillance, with GPS devices. Computers collect data on our purchases, on our Google searches, on our flights. At the beginning of 2020, the number of bytes in the digital universe was 40 times bigger than the number of stars in the observable universe. Google CEO at the time, Eric Schmidt, said, "From the dawn of civilization to 2003, 5 exabytes of data were created. The same amount was created in the last 2 days." And that was back in 2010. It's been growing exponentially since then. Okay, so you get it. We have a lot of data. This data is impossible to process by the human brain. It's so vast. But as AI gets better and faster, the massive storage of data is seen like oil in the ground when we were just beginning to learn how to extract it. It's this massive untapped potential, and there are companies that are working hard to become the go-to providers of services and software that helps corporations and governments tap into that data. So, what is Palantir? Palantir is named after those glowing orbs in Lord of the Rings, the ones that let you look anywhere in the world and see what's going on. You have to be this powerful person to be able to use it effectively. It's actually kind of an amazing name for this specific company. The company does deep data analysis to find connections that humans alone can't spot. Palantir is AI plus big data. Palantir's services are aimed at 3 industries: government, the finance sector, and legal research. One way to think of Palantir as a search engine for deep analysis of astronomically large amounts of data in real time. Here's a quick clip by Palantir that shows how their software can help governments detect and prevent threats by using data that could not be achieved before by human brains alone. Now, this scenario is imagined, but can you think of a recent global event where this exact thing happened? VDL.
An escalation could start with something as simple as the Chinese military conducting a routine exercise in the South China Sea. Monitoring the exercise, AI models running on satellite data detect an increased level of military activity. To the north, ship detection models identify an alarming buildup of fishing vessels surrounding a major Taiwanese port. An activity model detects that many of those ships are tied together, suggesting an ulterior motive and increasing the risk of a blockade. A new alert comes in from Japanese intelligence. The Chinese Luoyang destroyer has gone dark. The unmanned aircraft receives its mission and prepares for takeoff. Time is ticking, and they need to find the ship quickly. As the aircraft departs, video streams back to headquarters in real time. A ship identification model detects the dimensions, speed, and weapon system of the destroyer headed north. An analyst back in the operations center verifies the detection, which confirms the Luoyang is on the most dangerous path and is only a few hours away from the potential blockade. The first option involves sending reinforcements to a nearby base, which may take too long. The second option is to send a manned aircraft over the fishing vessels, which could introduce unnecessary risk. The third option is a freedom of navigation operation, which means positioning an American or allied ship closer to the developing situation. This option appears to have the highest probability of success. A task order is submitted, and the American ship quickly alters course. And as the American ship approaches, the fishing vessel blockade begins to disband, and the Luoyang continues north without incident.
In the clip above, you saw how Palantir can help the military to spot and respond to danger. It did so by 1, gathering data about the movement of ships and looking for anomalies. For example, in this video, it spotted that the ships were tied together, that a destroyer was missing, and that there was a seemingly unrelated military training nearby. It linked all of this to create an alert. It created a model of what could happen to determine where they needed to focus on next. The satellites were engaged to find the destroyer and track it. The model predicted several paths the destroyer could take, with one of those paths signaling that it was headed for the confrontation. And three, it created a model for potential solutions and chose the one with the highest rate of success. Now, right now, we don't know how much of the thinking and deciding is done with humans versus AI, but as AI is becoming more robust, it's likely more and more will be given over to the AI, with humans there to kind of oversee and veto as needed. Here's some specific real-life examples of Palantir's solutions. Now, a lot of these stories are hard to verify. Some are classified, some have been leaked, some are just rumors that the founders say that they can't talk about, but don't deny. But here are some of the more prominent ones. So Palantir software was used on over 40 years of financial records to help convict Bernie Madoff, the Ponzi scheme king. This was the largest Ponzi scheme conviction in history, with $64 billion in funds. The software quickly zeroed in on a few key moments of the whole Madoff saga, of his history with investors, and it was able to quickly build a timeline of events and a case against Madoff. Normally, this would probably take months or years and dozens of lawyers to pore over the data and find those little details. LAPD and Homeland Security uses Palantir. In fact, LAPD stated, "Detectives love the type of information Palantir provides. They can now do things that we could not do before. They can now exactly see great information and the links between events and people. It's brought great success to LAPD. It supports the cops in the streets and the officers doing the investigations. It's a great tool. They are becoming more efficient and more effective cops. Palantir is allowing them to better serve the public." As of 2013, Palantir was used by at least 12 groups within the US government, including the CIA, DHS, NSA, FBI, the CDC, the Marine Corps, the Air Force, Special Operations Command, West Point, the Joint IED Defeat Organization and Allies, the Recovery, Accountability and Transparency Board, and the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. There are multiple medical associations that are looking into testing it to help prevent fraud. Now, some parts of the US military actually attempted to build their own version of this data analysis tool. For example, the US Army developed its own, called the Distributed Common Ground System. It cost billions, and it was not very well received among users. 96% of warfighters in Afghanistan said that Palantir was their preferred choice. The company's tech helped locate Osama bin Laden in 2011 and is being used to trace COVID-19 infections, track medical supply chains, and even predict outbreaks in pandemic hot zones. In Iraq, the Pentagon used Palantir software to track patterns in roadside bomb deployment and worked out that garage door openers were being used as remote detonators. This is just the tip of the iceberg of what Palantir does. Literally, I mean that most of the stuff that they do is probably submerged and not visible. Palantir origins. Peter Thiel, in his 0-1 book, wrote about how early on in their PayPal journey, they found themselves having to filter through massive amounts of transactions to find fraud. No human being could process that many transactions in real time. They developed an automated solution, but the fraudsters quickly adapted and were able to get around the machine algo to continue submitting fraudulent transfers. So they created a hybrid system named Igor, after the Russian fraudster who bragged that they would never be able to stop him. The AI hybrid approach was incredibly effective and allowed PayPal to scale up, turn a profit, and eventually be sold in 2002. Yeah, this was over 20 years ago. During this time, the FBI even asked to use Igor to help detect financial crime, and the idea was planted. There was a growing need for this type of software for finding financial crimes, busting terrorist cells, and crime rings. Peter Thiel and friends founded Palantir in 2004, and the company booked $1 billion in sales in 2014, just 10 years later. I'm buying Palantir. I've started investing in Palantir shortly after its IPO in 2020, but sold off quickly because I was concerned about the speculative bubble that was growing around many stocks like Palantir at the time. I still believed in the long-term vision, but I could not shake the feeling that we were going to be in for a rough time in the market. Now, I got lucky. In general, timing the market is a fool's game. Market frenzies have these parabolic moves. It happened with Tesla, ARK, Peloton, and to an extent, Palantir. It's not saying anything about the stock. It's not saying anything about the company. It was just a period of free money and optimism that created a bubble. Now, I started buying again right around the time Russia invaded Ukraine. I feel that Palantir may be working behind the scenes in a lot of these conflicts. The Biden administration had advanced knowledge of this invasion. The video clip you saw earlier, that wasn't a real situation, but it sure seemed like it could have been. And that technology could have been used to determine when the invasion would start. It started with the troop movements. There were reports of Putin's boat being moved out of Germany shortly before everything went down. Later, there were reports of Russian oligarchs flying back to Russia all at the same time. Looking at all this data, you can make certain connections, certain models, and certain predictions about how global events will unfold. Having this vision for military reasons is important, of course, but there are also many people and companies that would pay vast fortunes to have access to this advanced knowledge to play the markets. In fact, Palantir Metropolis, aka Palantir Finance, is one of the lesser known products in the Palantir lineup that could eventually become larger than anything else Palantir has. At the end of the day, a lot of big tech CEOs and engineers are saying that AI is the future and that we are about to see an explosion in AI usefulness in the next 5 years. If I had to pick a few names that will benefit from this, top of my head, I would say Google, Tesla, and Palantir. Google is already massive due to their ads business. Tesla is great, but already highly valued. Palantir might be uniquely positioned to blow up in a good way. Plus, Peter Thiel, he doesn't really lose. He turned $2,000 in a Roth IRA into $5 billion, among other things. In his book, he has this concept, each moment happens once. Here's a quote. The next Bill Gates will not build an operating system. The next Larry Page or Sergey Brin won't make a search engine. And the next Mark Zuckerberg won't create a social network. If you are copying these guys, you aren't learning from them. In other words, they were the innovators that were at the right moment at the right time when something new was emerging that they built a company around that made them who they are. So what's the next big industry or industries on the horizon? Now, we're not really gonna know, but what I'm seeing is that I'm seeing AI, genomics, green energy, big data analytics, and cybersecurity. The next Gates or Page or Zuckerberg or Bezos, I think they're gonna be made in one of these industries. And I would not be surprised if the next Gates is Alex Karp and the next Amazon is Palantir. None of this is financial advice, of course. Investing in unprofitable tech startups is highly risky. Don't do it. But for me, I'm currently getting ready to put about 3% of my portfolio in Palantir, and I will be adding to it over time. If you are curious about Palantir and tech investing in general, hit subscribe. I'm going to be doing a lot more content about that in the future. Consider leaving me a comment. You can tell me why I'm wrong or ask a question or whatever else that you want. Liking, commenting, and subscribing also has the added benefit of getting the YouTube algorithm to push this video to more people. So if you want me talking about Palantir to more people, comment, like, share, and subscribe. My name is Wes Roth. Thank you for watching.